Researchers at the University of North Carolina School of Medicine estimate that more than 80% of Americans will experience an episode of low back pain at some time in their lives. The total cost of that condition is estimated at greater than $100 billion annually, with two-thirds of that due to decreased wages and productivity. There's no telling what those numbers are in the practice of dentistry. I'm convinced that dentistry was designed to mess with your back. Leaning over the dental chair all day stresses the back to the max. Back problems may be the biggest reason dentists have to cut back their chair time or have to quit dentistry altogether. Dr. Eric Goodman has not only saved the backs of countless dentists over the years, but he's saved the backs of people around the world with his non-invasive foundation training approach to back health that I'm convinced everyone needs to know in order to be physically productive throughout their life. So, whether you're the dentist, hygienist, or dental assistant leaning over patients all day, or an administrative team member leaning over a computer, get ready for a crown conversation with the man who will save your back, Dr. Eric Goodman.
Hello. Thank you for that kind welcome. I will do my best here to live up to it and hopefully teach you guys a little something before we get out of here. Nothing fancy today. I got 20 minutes. I want to do one very, very, at least to me, very, very important thing, which is educate you on one theory, foundation training, based on two principles, decompressing the torso and anchoring the pelvis. Quite literally pulling the body end to end so that the center gets stronger. Those two principles are supported by several exercises based on decompressing the torso and anchoring the pelvis, and I'm gonna teach you three of those today, no more. If I teach you four, you're gonna forget all of them. If I teach you two, not quite enough. If I teach you three of these exercises, you're gonna be able to feel a few really important things, the integration of a muscle chain on the back of your body called the posterior chain. You're going to feel your lower back muscles fatigue very quickly, but you're going to also feel at that same amount of time relief. And for a lot of people that are not in back pain, they're not in hip pain, they're not in knee pain, that relief feels a lot more like, oh, that's what it feels like to feel strong and supported, because pain is not the only issue that we deal with in foundation training. And in a room full of physicians and hygienists and health providers, I can't tell you anything how to be a better dentist. I can't tell you how to do any part of your job better, with the exception of the biomechanics associated with what you do day in, day out, for your entire career. My hope is that you have a long, happy, joyous career, much like I'm trying to have myself. We named this one spinal hygiene because it's appropriate for this room, but what I want you all to understand is not that you have to brush your teeth a certain way, but that does apply to this. It's not that you have to have a regimented amount of time that you have to do this in, or even if you don't do it every day, that's okay, but you have to steadily, relatively incessantly practice these postures and these positions for them to work well. Foundation training improves a lot of things. For right now, we're going to focus on compression, which happens throughout the entire body, from the ankles to the head. Compression is a series of symptoms. It is not an isolated pain, although pain sometimes presents as one of those symptoms. Compression is the torso invading its own space. How many of you are sitting against a backrest right now, at least until I just said that? Stop. Slide forward. Sit up a little bit taller. If it hurts your back, sit back, but I'm going to help you with that a little bit. How many of you are noticing right now that your hips are just sort of out there, pointed outwards? Bring your knees together just a little bit. Sit up a little taller as you do that. You'll notice it actually gets harder and harder with each of these small little subtle changes that we make. Now I want you to notice how many of your heads are just sort of guiding your body forward in front of you. I want you to take your chin and I want you to pull it back just a little bit. If you talk like this, you're doing great. Good. What we're trying to do is we're trying to pull the ends of the spine, the sacrum at the base of the spine and the occiput at the top of the spine away from each other. I don't want you to hyperextend your spine. I don't want you to flex your spine. I don't want you to think of any of that. I don't want you to fix your pelvic angle. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about taking every cell in the torso and expanding upon it, creating space for the entire torso. The skin expands. The rib cage expands. The chin pulls back, allowing the rib cage to lift up and forward, creating this really beautiful platform on which the shoulders rest, instead of the shoulders being this forward, deleterious weight on the torso. We've got to do that. We've got to really take that change. We have to make that change. You should not wear your shoulders like a jacket. It's not what they're meant for. Lift your chest, expand your sternum, pull the chin back, and as we do a couple of these exercises, you'll notice how quickly those things actually change. So first things first, the anatomy of decompression, which I'm going to give you a very brief summary of. The summary is this. The pec minors, these little muscles here, if they're pulling too tight forward, they're taking your shoulder blades up and over your clavicles into a very awkward position. But you can't make the changes that the pec minors and the chest muscles and the shoulders need at those muscles or at the shoulders. You instead have to inflate the rib cage as it is designed to be inflated. Because what happens when the rib cage inflates properly, when it pulls end to end, front, back, sides, when it's pushing the shoulders out of the way like a pair of balloons, lifting them upwards, instead of the shoulder muscles pulling them upwards, you start to feel vitality, support, something that we call structural integrity, which is such a good feeling to have. Structural integrity means that you believe in the body that you have. You believe that it can support you. You believe that you can go through an entire day, perhaps a lifetime, likely not, but certainly a day, knowing that your body is there for you, knowing that pain is not going to be the debilitating factor of that day. What I want you all to get, really, I mean, really get, is this idea that the rib cage is trapped if it can't expand. The postures we sit in, and I want you to pay attention to this as you're sitting right now. The postures that we sit in, they allow our rib cage to adapt towards rigidity, tightness, tension. The rib cage becomes a weight on top of the lungs, the sternum a pressure on top of the heart, the entire upper torso a downward pressure on digestive tissue, other visceral organs, just all sorts of really important stuff, reproductive tissue, all of that. The weight of the torso, and so many of us, is compressing on that. So we decompression breathe first. And what a decompression breath does is it sets the tone for the muscles that surround the rib cage, the muscles that surround the entire spine, to first lengthen against their own weight. And then as you exhale, we're trying to maintain every millimeter of that length, be it expansion outward, forward, backward, or upwards of the rib cage. And that is really hard to do. That's the eccentric, the negative, a muscle going from a shortened position under tension to a longer position. The eccentric portion of decompression breathing is where the magic happens, the exhale. Keeping the torso as big and expansive as possible, the chin back as far as it can be, the shoulders open, the chest open, throughout every exhale as you build on that expansion with every inhale. Before I go any further, I want everybody to take three breaths. And all I want you to think is nothing accurate, nothing has to be perfect. Think of your lungs as two balloons that are relatively deflated, and all you're trying to do is inflate them, especially posteriorly, especially into the back of the rib cage, as big as you can for three breaths. And on that last breath or two, I want you to try to maintain all of that height and all of that width. And then when you're done, I'm probably going to have you stand up a little bit to practice a bit more. So everybody, three breaths. Huge on the inhale, like the ribs are just lifting out of the way because of the building pressure and expansion underneath them. You'll notice if your head is forward, it gets very difficult to lift your chest, so create length at the neck. Let the shoulders open and fall back. Decompression breathing is one of the primary components of my work. It's what I've taught a lot of people all around the world to do, and it's the thing that I will bet will help you more than any other pose that I can teach you because it facilitates all of the other poses that I can teach you. So this very basic breathing process takes about 2 weeks to learn. Your body has to adapt to the strength required to maintain its accurate, human, powerful posture. And posture requires a lot of power. Therefore, being a dentist, being a hygienist, in the right postures is not going to be the easiest task you undertake, but it'll be one of the most important and one of the most impactful. Go ahead and stand up for me. This is like the easiest way to get everybody in standing ovation I'm going to do this right at the very like last couple seconds. We're going to do this again. Except that time we're just going to clap and like holler and stuff like that. So I don't have a lot of words up here. I just have the name of the exercise and a relatively thin young man doing the exercise. This is Brian. He's one of my primary instructors. And if you've ever watched any foundation training videos, you have probably seen him before. What Brian is doing is an isometric exercise that challenges, really does challenge, two specific groups of muscles. The anchoring muscles along the inside of the thigh from the arches of the feet all the way upward towards the pubic symphysis, sharing an inward and upward pull and contraction that basically pulls the arches up towards the groin muscles. Those are squeezing together without your knees collapsing inward. You'll notice Brian's feet are touching. The next thing is that his hands are supinated, meaning the palms are forward, and what's considered in every form of biomechanics and anatomical instruction to be anatomical position, because that's what human beings look like. But what happens is over time, this crap starts to go on, and all of a sudden, this position is incredibly hard to hold, much harder than it should be. So let's try to hold it a little bit. What you're going to notice on Brian is that there is this piece of his hand, the hypothenar region along the pinky line and the inner forearm, that is attached to his trochanter, the hip bone that you can feel when you do this. I want you to press in. Press the two together. And as you do that, I want you to take those same big, strong, expansive, powerful, deep breaths that we did in that seated posture. This time, you're going to be able to put a lot more emphasis into it. This time, you're going to start feeling a lot of muscles going on around here, starting to lift, starting to tighten up as you lift. What you can't really tell is that Brian is in a subtle hip hinge. There is this little bit of movement of his hips, his tailbone pulling behind him as his entire torso lifts upward away from it to avoid any form of hyperextension at the lower back. I want everybody to squeeze the legs just a little harder. Squeeze the heels, squeeze the balls of the big toe together. Pull your chin back one more time with that chin pulling back like this. Let's take that big decompression breath and allow the sternum to expand. And now as you exhale, try not to let it drop. And let yourself relax a little bit. Go ahead and have a seat. Take it easy. Instead of having you do the next exercise, I'm just going to talk about the next exercise. And if anybody wants to get up and do it, you're more than welcome to. But my real suggestion is that you do this when you get home and you can practice accurately, because that's much more important than just a little quick demo we can do in here. The next exercise is a lunge decompression. And you're going to start seeing a very familiar thing here, which is that our decompression exercises are named decompression with various body postures. All I want you to do is practice the breathing process that makes your body stronger. This is not the way you're supposed to breathe all the time in any way, shape, or form. But when you're doing foundation training, this is exactly how you're meant to breathe, as big and expansively as possible. So in a lunge position, you're going to notice that the hips are squared forward, another paramount feature of every foundation training pose you're going to learn. The hips must remain square so that we can get the butt muscles, the glutes, and other large, strong posterior chain muscles to be our primary muscles of propulsion and stability, our primary support structures. When we unsquare those hips, we're not practicing corrective exercise for the detriment of this compressed posture that externally rotates our hips. So we square them. It's that simple. What we're also going to do, though, is apply this equal and opposite pressure between the front and back leg. The front leg is going to pull backwards, initiating the muscles of support along the entire back of the thigh from the heel to the glutes. The back leg is then going to pull forward, initiating the front of the leg muscles, the hip flexors, the shins, even the top of the toes are going to be activated a little bit. And that counter pressure is going to be providing something very important called anchoring. In about two slides, I get to that anchoring discussion to help you understand that the downward pull at the base of the pelvis is equally important to the upward pull of the torso. The way that decompression postures work when they're working well, the top lifts and expands as the bottom tightens. The stronger, the more stable that base, that pelvic girdle, the more forceful and resistance-based that upward expansion can be, and the faster you improve, The faster you get stronger, the faster your body integrates, and the faster you get to feel structural integrity, which again, feels really good. So, structural integrity comes from two things. The axial skeleton with healthy, accurate communication to the appendicular skeleton. The axial skeleton is the center, the axis. It's where the primary central nervous system goes and communicates with the rest of the body. That axial skeleton in most people, and I'm not talking 8 out of 10, I'm talking like 9.974 out of 10, need to re-educate their axial skeleton towards expansion, lift, openness, the ability to resist the constant pressure of gravity in this position instead of this position. Your body over time adapts to these positions more than you recognize, and your axial and appendicular skeleton, by the time you're 10, 12, 15, 20 years old, has really become very set and ingrained in its patterns. This isn't an exercise program for 20-year-olds. This is an exercise program for human bodies of any age that will probably make improvements with it. As dentists, you guys are all relatively healthy, active. You're at least in a profession that offers you the ability to move and hinge and bend and lift and interact with other bodies all day. Don't just do it sitting in a chair. Stand up. Learn to hinge properly. Learn to decompress the torso properly. Learn to re-educate your axial skeleton through daily practice of this breathing pattern, 3, 4, 5 minutes a day, that's it. To allow that axial skeleton to give the appendicular skeleton the right platform to pull against. The upper appendicular skeleton, the limbs, the upper limbs, the arms, they kind of fall into this internal rotation, droopy pattern. Again, you should not be wearing your shoulders like a jacket or like a cloak. So we have to re-educate the appendicular skeleton of the upper limbs towards external rotation and inward pull towards the joint. Really important muscles, the lats, the posterior capsule of the shoulders, those all come into play, but it's not just them. It's the adductors and the arches that even go and affect the shoulders and affect the neck. Your body is this beautifully interconnected web of tissue. It is more connected than even the most scientific minds in that field of studying interconnectivity can even fathom. They're learning new stuff about the vastness of the communication systems in our body every day. And I don't begin to understand any of that, trust me. I understand foundation training. That's about it. I can surf a little. That's about it. Nothing else. But with foundation training, what I can offer is for those people that are studying all of that interconnected tissue, those dentists, those different forms of doctors that are out there using that interconnected form of tissue to help other bodies, I can offer you expansion. I can offer you the ability to take all of that tissue and make it function as efficiently as it is designed to function. And usually, that feels a lot less painful and a lot more energized. So anchoring is the downward pull. It's the bottom half of that integrated system. It's the, you ever see those finger cuffs where you put your finger in one end and the other and you pull them apart? It's one of those fingers, whichever's the bottom one. Anchoring provides that contra pull to decompression, to that upward, outward lift of decompression, which left alone takes you back here into extension. But when you stabilize it from below with these anchoring muscles, you get equal and opposite resistance that makes the entire body a stronger system. And that's what we want our body to be. The anchoring anatomy is very simple. The muscles that connect to the base of your pelvis, connecting the thigh and the pelvis together, those are anchoring muscles. They're like the lower half of your core. Your pelvis is the central structure of your body. Therefore, any muscle above, below, in front of, behind, within, if it attaches directly to that central structure, that fulcrum at the pelvis, it's a core muscle. Half of them, if not more, occur below the pelvis, and those are the anchoring muscles. You'll notice the oriented arrows. The guy on the screen here is actually the model for my new book and a new lecture series that I have coming out. He's a 6'8" Olympic medalist. I'm not sure if he's a medalist, but he's an Olympian from Canada. He's gigantic. I needed to find a body that made these exercises look the way they feel. That's a founder. The founder is the primary posterior chain integration exercise of foundation training. It's the most important exercise I can ever teach you. It's the most important exercise that I do every day. But you can't do that exercise right away. You got to learn the steps. You got to learn the breath process. You got to learn the anchoring process. And that's why I'm up here, is to intrigue you enough to take the time to do that. Not everybody that comes to my work will get better. I promise you that. You can't. There's no cure-alls. There's no such thing. But I bet a lot of you will. I've seen so much crazy stuff happen with foundation training, none crazier than what I have personally felt myself, which is the reason that I created all of this exercise, is I was a chiropractor that could not get better, which is a very frustrating thing to be, especially when it's back pain. What I had to do was strengthen my back to the point of absurdity, which I have. And I hope you all do the same, because it's not that hard and it's not that absurd. Looks a little funny, but our slogan is, I don't care what it looks like, it just feels good for that very reason. I want you trying this often. This is good timing. I have 45 seconds left on the last slide. I'm proud of myself right now. Timing is not my strong point, but foundation training is, and I have a new book coming out soon about that very topic, True to Form. It's not available till May. It's the book I've always wanted to write. It took me 4 years to do, and it explains the processes of decompression and anchoring as they pertain to any physician in the entire world and any patient of those physicians. You have a human body regardless of how you use it, and the work that we teach at foundation training is going to do nothing more than allow that body to work more as it should, as it's designed to. It is not a cure-all. It is not even an instead of. When you learn this work, when you learn foundation training, you are learning something to use as an accessory to whatever it is you do in your life, be it yoga, riding a bike, dentistry, plastic surgery, skydiving, firefighting, I don't care. If you have a body, what I can do is offer you something that makes it feel better. And I really, truly hope you take me up on that. As you see on this slide, if you have any interest in understanding more of what we do, you can go to our website. We've got free videos, which I really ask everybody to use before you buy anything from us. Make sure you like it. Use the free stuff. It's there. It's not going anywhere. Once you've used that, go to the website, and we have everything from books and DVDs to really in-depth certifications that will alter your perspective on health, much like they continue to alter all of ours that teach it steadily, constantly. I'm a young guy. My team is very young. We're going to be doing this for the rest of our lives. I sincerely appreciate everybody having me up here, listening to me. If you try it, I appreciate that even more. And if you get better from it, that's what I really want to see. So thank you very much, Crown Council. It was really cool to be up here. And thanks, folks.